Hello, my friends, and thank you. Thank you for joining us. A little virtual pat on the shoulder there. Whatever time it is where you are, it is a good time to worship God. Welcome. I'm Fred Evenson, the senior minister here at Peacedale Congregational Church. We're an open and affirming congregation, which means that no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, no matter your skin color, or who you love, we welcome you. And we are so glad that you are joining us here today. All are welcome. Please refer to our Elite newsletter for any announcements. Although I would like to ring out loud the announcement that we are holding a Bible study beginning next week on the 24th. We're beginning a new Bible study for 6 weeks. On Sunday mornings around 11 o'clock. So call the office if you're interested in joining us as we really get into the Word. You know, I always like to begin with a question. And it usually has to do with the scripture reading. Although today, the question has to do with the fortress that has emerged in our nation's capital in preparations for the inauguration. I'm sure you've seen the images of the National Guard in the Capitol building. When was the last time any military unit was staged inside the Capitol building itself? Anybody? Anybody? The answer is, it was during the race riots following the death of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. That's right. It is somewhat ironic for our nation that we will be celebrating Dr. King on Monday. And here we are again with the military in the Capitol building. It makes you wonder what he would say about all of these events, how he would view them. Our scripture reading today is about vision and what it means to love our sisters and brothers by seeing more clearly. And so we begin with a song about loving God and loving people. We invite you to join in.
I've been running in circles, jumping the hurdles, getting caught in that rush of doing so much. I'm feeling kind of worn out. All this checking the boxes, trying to be flawless, has me spinning my head, catching my breath, too afraid to slow down. I tell myself to keep this up, that God wants more than just my love. I've been complicating things, it's just like me to overthink. Gotta keep it real simple, keep it real simple. Bring everything right back to ground zero, 'cause it all comes down to this. Love God and love people. We're living in a world that keeps breaking, but if we wanna find a way to change it, it all comes down to this. Love God and love people. All of this freedom, the keys to the kingdom. Knowing life will be found when love can be loud, 'cause love is what it's all about. I tell myself to keep this up, God wants more than just my love. I want more complicating things, it's just like me to overthink. Gotta keep it real simple, keep it real simple. Bring everything right back to ground zero, 'cause it all comes down to this. Love God and love people. We're living in a world that keeps breaking, but if we want to find a way to change it, it all comes down to this. Love God and love people. Love is patient, love is kind, rescues hearts and changes lives. Love is all we need to make things right. Gotta keep it real simple. It's really so simple. Because it all comes down to this. Love God and love people. We're living in the world that keeps breaking. But if we want to find a way to change it, because it all comes down to this. Love God and love people.
Let's join together now in a spirit of prayer. Gracious God, it really does all come down to this. Loving you and loving people. And we continue to realize that we need help. And so we come to you right now, God. We come to you asking, you know, God, that you made us one body with many members, and yet we seem to think that we can divide the body and divide ourselves from the whole. And we know, God, that our redemption is found in you, that reconciliation is the way forward. And so we ask, God, that you would help our body to find wholeness and reconciliation with each other and with you. Help us, God, to see ourselves the way you see us. Help us to believe in ourselves the way you believe in us. Help us to see our neighbors and you more clearly. God, we ask that you would correct our vision, that you would be our vision. Oh, we adore you, God. Thank you for being with us here right now. It is in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Let's sing together now, Be Thou My Vision.
Be Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom and thou my true word. I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord. Thou my redeemer, my love thou hast won. Thou in me dwelling and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor vain empty praise. Thou mine inheritance now and always. Thou and thou only first in my heart. Great God of heaven, my treasure thou art. Great God of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's joy, so bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
And now, let's listen for the word of God.
The scripture reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, verses 1 through 5. Do not judge so that you may not be judged, but with the judgment you make, you will be judged, and the measure you give will be the measure you get. Why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye? Or how can you say to your neighbor, "Let me take the speck out of your eye," while the log is in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
In memory of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I have been looking at the events surrounding the marches in Selma. The main issue at hand was, of course, racism, but the legislative focus was on voting rights. And immediately we see a connection with what happened last week. See, in Selma, it was about a people who felt that they had no voice. Specifically with regards to voting. It was the people who felt oppressed, people who felt disenfranchised, and who engaged in a march in order to try and change the laws. And we begin to understand the passions behind wanting to ensure that your vote is counted. Of course, our recent election was lawfully certified by all the states. But what if you don't believe that? What if you are told by your political leader that the votes weren't counted correctly? Because if your vote doesn't count, then you have no voice in the political direction of the country and in your own destiny. And in a sense, it means you don't count. And so we begin to understand the outrage, right, that might cause someone to join a protest march. Now, let me be clear, that in no way excuses the violent attack on the Capitol building. And I know compared to the march from Selma to what we saw last week, it's not a great analogy, right, for many reasons. But it gives us a glimpse of why. Why Jesus reminds us to be slow to judge. Until we're able to clear our own eyes, self-reflection is critical, especially in such an incendiary environment. It's been said that most of us are umpires at heart. We like to call balls and strikes on somebody else. It's so easy to be critical and judgmental, isn't it? But Jesus, he has something to say. Let's look at Matthew's gospel first. Jesus finishes up the Sermon on the Mount here, and as he winds up for the big finish, he teaches us something that is so important. It's recorded in our sacred texts in more than one place. We just heard it in Matthew. Right? Do not judge so that you may not be judged. It's also in Luke's gospel in chapter 7. Jesus says, be merciful as your Father is merciful. Do not judge and you will not be judged. Do not condemn and you will not be condemned. Forgive and you will be forgiven. Now, this is a relatively new teaching for his hearers. He's telling them to be merciful and humble. Have you ever complained about someone else and their negative attitude and the way they like to talk about other people behind their backs? And it's at this point Jesus asks us, now who's being negative and who's talking about whom behind their back? Or what about judgmental comments about other people's race or gender or sexual orientation? Now, of course, we must make decisions, right, all the time regarding right and wrong. And Jesus does say that we should notice the fruit that people are producing right after this. He ties this non-judgmental command to vision. In both Matthew and in Luke, we find a similar teaching. Jesus says, first take the log out of your own eye, right? And then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. He's not saying don't hold people accountable. But first, Jesus is calling us, all of us, to be self-critical. He's asking us to take a closer look at ourselves and how we see the world. You know, what a comical image, having this log stuck in your eye and not even being aware of it, right? But it happens. We think we're doing great, but Jesus reminds us to check our blind spots. Some of you know about macular degeneration. That's the loss of vision, especially in the center of where you are looking. And Jesus is saying, some of us, many of us, have these blind spots when it comes to living God's love. Kind of like the blind spot on your car. When someone is passing you on the right or the left, there are areas that our mirrors just don't see, right? But by sitting at Jesus' feet and listening for God's word and praying and allowing God's Spirit to fill us, we begin to see what's in those blind spots. The prophets of old are famous for pointing out the nation's blind spots. And tomorrow, on Monday, we will celebrate one of those prophets, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who had a dream that we would one day notice our blind spots that allow us to prejudge one another. It was a dream that our vision might be corrected, especially when it comes to racial discrimination and racial injustice. It was a dream that we might come together finally as a beloved community, sisters and brothers. He once said, we may have all come on different ships, but we're all in the same boat now. In Bob Marley's words, we all have one heart and one love. The color of our skin, the country of our origin, are not as important as the fact that we are one human family. Especially in America, we may have come on different ships, and unfortunately, some on floating prisons. But we are in the same boat now. And sometimes it takes a prophet like Dr. King to help us remove the log, to tell us what's in our blind spot. Now, I want to be really careful here. Just because we are in the same boat, it doesn't mean we see the world the same way. I attended a webinar by a UCC minister, the Reverend Tracy Blackman. It was a conversation about how to respond to our nation's present spiritual crisis. And during that dialogue, the legendary civil rights activist, Ruby Sales, she goes all the way back to the SNCC. Some of you may know it's the Student Nonviolent coordinating committee that you hear about in the movie Selma, which I highly recommend, by the way, if you'd like to watch that and learn more about Dr. King and those events. But Ruby distinguishes between the black gaze in terms of vision and the white gaze, the different lenses through which we see the world. And regarding the events on January 6th, Reverend Blackman talks about how she hears shock from those who are not kissed by the sun in their hue. We are shocked that anyone would dare do such a thing to our Capitol building. But she asked the question, can you imagine if it was a group of black people charging the Capitol building? And she showed two pictures on the screen. One of them reveals the National Guard in riot gear at a peaceful Black Lives Matter protest over the summer. They're on the steps there to the Lincoln Memorial. The other shows the Capitol steps on January 6th, last week. And she says, look at the difference. Just look at the difference in the response to people in black skin who show up to protest and fight for their lives versus the people who showed up in their white skin to overthrow democracy. Now, we may know these are not exactly the same situation. They're not the same scenarios, right? But she points out in both cases, the arrival was not, it wasn't a secret. And you can see the preparations and the response. They were entirely different. The black community sees this event through a different lens. And that's the point. And her two African-American colleagues agree. I heard another person of color say, you know, I would have been shot. We would have been shot. We wouldn't have even made it up the steps if that was us. And Reverend Blackman said, those pictures, they're hard to look at. And we're not even talking about the pictures of the Confederate flag carried through the Capitol or the guy wearing the Camp Auschwitz shirt or things like that. But a couple of days ago, I mentioned this question of perspective that Dr. Blackman points out to a local pastor of a church that is comprised of people of color. And she said, yes. She said, they see it. They notice it. It's par for the course. Sadly, they've come to expect it. Former President Lyndon Johnson gave a speech regarding the violence at the Edmund Pettus Bridge near Selma, in which he said the following. He said, as at times history and fate meet at a single time, in a single place, and so it was last week in Selma, Alabama. There, long-suffering men and women peacefully protested the denial of their rights as Americans. And rarely in any time does an issue lay bare the secret heart of America itself. The issue for equal rights for the American Negro is that issue. For this issue, many of them were brutally assaulted. There is no Negro problem, he said. There is no Southern problem. There is only an American problem. Over the years, we have definitely made progress regarding civil rights and racial justice. But have we learned anything from 2020, along with recent events? My friends, we still have an American problem. President Johnson went on to say in his speech, and we are met here tonight as Americans, not as Democrats or Republicans. We are met here as Americans to solve that problem. This was the first nation in history, in the history of the world, to be founded with a purpose. The great phrases of that purpose still sound in every American heart. north and south, all men are created equal. What happens in Selma or Cincinnati, or I would add at the Capitol, is a matter of legitimate concern to every American. But let each of us, he said, look within our hearts and our own communities, and let each of us put our shoulder to the wheel to root out injustice wherever it exists. Now, this is Dr. King's weekend, and I think he, like Jesus, would ask the question, how are we removing the log from our own eyes? How are we checking our blind spots? How healthy is our vision? My colleague, the Reverend Angela Segisi, said, if you want to build bridges, then you have to go to the people that you want to build bridges with. Go where the people are. And so, if we truly want to see more clearly, if we want to check our biases and build bridges to those who see the world differently than we do, then we need to go where they are. This means partnering with other churches, like the Reverend Segisi's. It means reaching out to people of the opposite political party with a willingness to listen to how they see the world. Jesus was an eye doctor of sorts. He helped people see more clearly. He healed their vision in many ways. In our faith family, we have spent time discerning our vision for who we are called to be. And shalom, the Hebrew concept of peace and wholeness, has bubbled up as a great way to possibly describe our vision. It's becoming clear that we feel called by Christ to work for the peace of Christ, for wholeness and justice and reconciliation. We continue to look for ways to humbly meet the other's gaze. The good news is that we have come a long way, right? But our society isn't there yet. Prejudice, think about that word, prejudgment of others, and racial bias, they remain issues. Jesus' connection of judgment and vision, it's profound. When Dr. King and his march finally arrived in Montgomery, after 54 miles traveling from Selma, he gave a speech saying, I know you are asking today, how long will it take? Somebody's asking, how long will prejudice blind the visions of men, darken their understanding, and drive out the bright-eyed wisdom from her sacred throne? And he goes on to ask, how long will justice be crucified and truth buried? I come to say to you this afternoon, however difficult the moment, however frustrating the hour, it will not be long, because truth crushed to earth will rise again. How long? Not long. Because no lie can live forever. How long? Not long. Because you shall reap what you sow. How long? Not long. Because the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. How long? Not long. Because mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. His truth is marching on. My friends, may it not be long that God's vision for humanity, a just, beloved community, might finally become reality. Amen.
Oh, let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. And let us be a holy nation where pride and prejudice shall cease. Let us speak the truth in love to the lost and least of these. Let us serve the Lord in unity so others will believe. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. Oh, let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. And let us build on one foundation till he comes and the wars of men shall cease. Let us share the love of Jesus without hypocrisy. Let mercy and forgiveness begin with you and me. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. Have we not one Father? Have we not one faith? Have we not one calling to become one holy race? Oh, let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. Let us pray for restoration and seek the Lord together on our knees. Let us keep our hearts from evil and cling to what is good. Let us honor one another and love our brotherhood. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace.
Let's pray. Gracious God, let us be a generation of reconciliation and peace. Loving God, we look to you this day. Your kindness leads us to this place of reflection, as we ask how we might all see fit to do better. And we thank you. God, we thank you for giving us a vision of your kingdom, a vision of the beloved community. And so we lift up all who are sick and we ask God for healing. We lift up our nation and the world and we ask for healing. And we pray, God, we pray using your word and using Dr. King's words, God, we pray and now unto you who is able to keep us from falling And now, unto you, who is able to lift us up from the fatigue of despair to the buoyancy of hope. And now unto you, who is able to solve the race problem, if we will cooperate with you. And now unto you, who is able to transform this cosmic energy into a constructive force. And now unto you, who is able to transform this midnight of injustice into a glowing daybreak of freedom and justice. To you be the power and authority, majesty and dominion, now, henceforth, and forevermore, as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to say. And together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now as we continue to give thanks for the light of Christ's reconciling love in our lives, we respond. We respond with our offering, whether it be with our time and our talents or financially. We present our gifts to God. And the mission of the month is the Johnny Cake Center. And so you can designate a financial gift to the local food pantry, the Johnny Cake Center for Hope, or you can give the newly created crisis fund that is housed at the Johnny Cake Center. If you want to give to that fund, just write "In This Together" in the memo portion of the check. In This Together. And this crisis fund helps with rental assistance and that sort of thing at the Johnny Cake Center. But there are multiple ways to give to the ministries of this church. You can see that on the screen right now. But may our gifts reflect God's boundless generosity. And now, as you go forth, may the love of God surround you, and may we all see our way clear to live the great fellowship of love to which Christ calls us. Amen and shalom.
Let us pray for restoration and seek the Lord together on our knees. Let us keep our hearts from evil and cling to what is good. Let us honor one another and love our brotherhood. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace. Let us be the generation of reconciliation and peace.